Podcast is part of the Pod Syndicate family. For more criminally compelling shows, articles, and conversations, head to wearepodsyndicate.com.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Rewatch Project. I'm Mike, and with me, as always, is Hannah. How the devil are you?
Oh, slightly crippled, but fine.
I feel like you need to explain that.
Well, I've been training for a half marathon with my friends, and I appear to have hurt my leg quite significantly, and am now on crutches. So I'm hoping that I can get myself sorted before the race in 5 weeks. Otherwise, I will be the support crew.
Well, and as is befitting a podcast about TV show franchises, Hannah is podcasting from a lazy boy.
Yes, at the moment. I am.
So I think that's quite appropriate in many ways. But yes, welcome back, everybody. This is episode 7 of the podcast, which finds us on episode number
11.
11 of season 1 of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Before we get into that, though, I just want to do a quick little bit of housekeeping here. Just remind people of our various presences on the old Soch and various other sources.
Don't even say that again.
Well, no, but that's how all the lit people. No, I'm going to stop pressing.
Listen,
Bay. Yeah, sorry. Yes, Queen. If you want to reach us, you can do that. I always forget to do this, so I'll do it at the top of the show. At rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com, and on Twitter we are at rewatchproj. That's rewatch, P-R-O-J. And our main feed is at anchor.fm, but really you can find us everywhere. So,
have we had any emails?
I haven't actually checked. Let me have a look. No, that's one we've already read. No, we haven't since we last recorded.
Okay.
But I only put the episode up like a day or two ago, yep. So that is hardly any surprise. But feedback would be good. It'd be great to hear from you, particularly if you are, or not even particularly if you're watching these for the first time, but let us know how you're watching these, what your experiences are with the show, and whether you agree or disagree.
Absolutely.
With anything we see. Are we, yep. Because it's a bit of a love fest on this show. Are we going too easy on it? Is there any sort of, critical stuff that people want to share? Yeah. So do you want to tell us, Hannah, which episode we are going to be covering this evening?
So we are covering the episode, season 1, episode 11, The Magical Place. Plot synopsis says, S.H.I.E.L.D. organises a full-scale hunt for Coulson. Centipede tries to resurface the memories on what happened after Coulson died. It's directed by Kevin Hooks, who seems to be a real jobbing director. Had a small role in Inner Space.
Oh, yeah, Dwayne from Inner Space.
Yes.
Oh, wow, he directed Passenger 57.
Yeah.
Always bet on black. That's the line I always remember from that film. Done a bunch of Prison Break as well, and
he's done some Preacher episodes, I noticed, and various well-known current TV shows. The This Is Us. I haven't seen that before myself.
The Orville.
Oh, has he done The Orville? I haven't seen that. Yep.
X-Files.
Two or three episodes of lots of different things.
It's funny. I think that although this episode is now 7 years old, I get the feeling that a lot of the directors on this show were quite young.
Yeah.
I think a new generation was coming through. I think a lot of those techniques. And the reason I say that is I noticed that loads of them have written for the X-Files. But it's all the reboot, the sort of how it came back a few years ago. Mm. It's all of those ones that they seem to have worked on. So
he did quite a few episodes of Prison Break, just looking down his biography.
I'm guessing that this
he
was...
has that connection, Lost, Alias.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's weird. It's as though the mutant enemy people, which is Joss Whedon's people, and the bad robot, there seems to be a lot of crossover between those ones. It's they've got very similar. I mean, I've always felt that the bad robot, the J.J. Abrams ones, they're a lot slicker in many ways. Like they're a little bit more, I suppose, kind of corporate. Whereas Joss Whedon, even when he's done the big Marvel stuff, there's a kind of scrappiness to what he does, and a little bit more. I hate to use this dawned on me a lot watching Age of Ultron the other night. There's a little bit more kind of artiness to Joss Whedon, whereas J.J. Abrams is sort of on the Venn diagram. If you've got Joss Whedon on one extreme and Michael Bay on the other extreme. I'd say J.J. Abrams is kind of somewhere in the middle in a lot of ways.
Yeah. So, Kevin Hooks directed.
So this is written by Paul Zibiszewski. Yep.
Who I've butchered his surname once again. and also Brent Fletcher.
Yeah, yeah. So we've got, between them, we've got like Lost.
Lost, Spartacus.
Yeah.
Friday Night Lights, Angel.
Yeah.
Is that, you know, just that crossover you would expect.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's, I mean, Spartacus as well, that was created by Stephen Esther Knight, whose first ever writing gig was Buffy.
Right, okay, so that totally makes sense.
It all kind of, you know, it's a real melting pot. But yeah, okay, well, I mean, how we normally do this, as you will know by now, is that we will do a non-spoiler section, and then we'll do a little bit of spoiler stuff. I tell you what, I've really got to figure out the naming conventions on this podcast, because it's really confusing that we've got the number of the Rewatch Project episode it is, and then a conflicting number for the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. So I think really what I'll probably start doing is just, I did this last couple of episodes, is put the name of the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. episode in the episode title.
Yeah, I think so.
And that will be the signifier. But really, all that you need to know is that we are at the midpoint of
season one.
Yeah, I mean, so this episode, actually, when did this first air? Could you bring it back up on IMDb?
Sure.
Because I believe that last week's episode was the mid-season cliffhanger.
7th of January 2014.
Yeah. So the last episode will have been on before Christmas.
Yeah.
And that's why you've got the big cliffhanger thing. It's the classic, I mean, all American TV shows used to do this, where you'd have that mid-season break, and usually you'd get some kind of cliffhanger, and I think this is no different, really.
Yeah.
You know, we're returning after, you know, a lot of plot elements are left hanging. So let's see what happens. I remember this episode in really broad terms, but I feel like now I'm more into the show and I'm paying closer attention, and I'm more kind of well versed in the MCU. I'm kind of looking forward to this one and actually giving it a bit more attention than I probably gave it last time.
I'm really looking forward to giving it some attention, because I don't remember it at all.
I mean, I know what it's about in broad story,
I know what
but
it's
I can't
about
remember
too, but
what actually happens, like the actual intricacies of the plot.
No.
So it'll be all new.
It will be.
That's the great thing about ravaging one's mind and body.
Indeed.
Is that you get to enjoy it again. I mean, Christ almighty, it's like the
Don't
Simpsons.
Don't underestimate the power of alcohol.
Yeah, it's like the classic era of The Simpsons. I had to watch those episodes about 5 times before they took, and it was great every time. It was just like I got to hit reboot and enjoy them again. But, okay, well, we will hit pause and we will watch the episode, and we will be back with you very shortly.
Have you ever wondered what so-called family films will scar your kids forever?
Putting 4 and 5-year-olds in front of this movie, it's like, if they didn't know what death was before this, they're going to know it after it.
They're going to know it after it, and they're going to be freaking terrified.
And they're going to be questioning you.
Yeah.
Or do you have the slight suspicion that your loved one has a cold, dead heart?
Yeah, The Dark Knight has got like all the orphans, and like, oh no, we're going to die. They did not build up those orphans at all. In my head, it's like, kill them.
Then look no further. The His Film Her Movie podcast is the show for you. It's the movie podcast that celebrates the contrasting cinematic tastes of its hosts. So join Jordan and Lauren every week on their unique journey through the land of the silver screen. So if you're looking for a few laughs, some fun film-related chat, then get involved. You can find us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts.
January. Your favorite new fall TV show returns.
No single agent is that important.
Coulson is.
As danger hits all new height.
We've never done anything like this before.
It's time, Simmons. Embrace the change.
A team struggling for unity.
Stay away from that girl. Wherever she goes, death follows.
We need to root out all the secrets.
You can never tell her.
And one man's shocking mystery is finally revealed.
You were killed. Now you're here. We want to know how.
Please, I'm begging you, let me die.
Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. returns with all new episodes Tuesday, January 7th on ABC. And see full episodes now on Watch ABC Online or download the app.
Don't touch Lola.
Okay, and we are back. So we are now into the second half of season one of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Indeed.
And we have just watched episode 11. And what were your initial thoughts, Hannah?
I couldn't remember this episode but at all. But obviously because I know what happens in the season in general, I had a fair idea of where it was going.
But as a 45 minutes of television,
I was going in pretty blind.
Yeah. 7 years ago.
Yeah.
We've had a lot of sleepless nights with children
since. We have. I would have been pregnant with our daughter when I watched this the first time.
So you were out of your fucking mind, weren't you?
Totally out of my mind.
You were like Coulson in that CAT scan machine at the end going, let me die.
I loved it. I thought it was really, really good. It was a lot more solid than I was expecting it to be. I thought it would be... There was more to unpack in it than I was expecting. Yeah, what did you think?
I thought it was awesome. And echo all of that is I can remember it in a broad tapestry of the show way. Like I remembered, Coulson being in
Coulson in the machine and that's pretty much it.
But it was very much kind of, it's funny. And this is why I think the whole rewatch element of this podcast, the Rewatch Project. Although, having said that, I don't think necessarily all the things that we will ever cover in the show will be rewatches. But I think this episode's a really good example of how your perspective changes when you've seen a show before. Not just from the Babylon 5 syndrome of, this was there at that point, but there's elements of that with this show, but more just from the perspective of the knowing it's a good show factor that we've talked about before.
For sure. Yeah.
So my experience when I first saw this was probably a really interesting episode of a show that I think's good. And with characters that I think I like. But rewatching it, knowing my greater view of the show, not just from a storyline perspective, but from an opinion and a fan perspective, it makes me realise that. But also, the thing that really stuck out for me on this episode as well, and this is something that I haven't really talked about that much in relation to this show, was the filmmaking. Like, I thought it looked really good.
Yeah, I
thought it was really well directed, and I thought the performances were good. It just felt like, as a production, from an execution perspective, it had gone up a level from the previous episodes. Like, the shots, like, for example, I mean, we will start breaking it down in a moment, but there's a shot where... And it's not even a really terribly important moment, but it was a moment when I was watching the episode where I just thought, wow, this is, there's some thought going into this, is the shot where Skye pulls into that sort of the nuclear test village in the car. And it's like a low angle and she gets out. And it's just a really beautifully framed shot of her in the desert with the sun behind, really nice cinematography. You've got the dust in the air. You've got kind of like an eerie kind of soundtrack thing going on. And it's just... artistically, it's really well done. And there's moments and I'll get into the specifics of this later, but there's moments where characters are talking to each other and they're quite intense scenes. And the performances, but also, as silly as it sounds, like the lighting and the makeup and the technical aspects of it were really good. And it's as though that I think that they realised, I think that this was the first episode after a break, so they'd had a break. And I feel almost as though the whole production... the writers, the actors, but also the crew and the people who make the show came back. You get a sense of almost reinvigoration. They're like, this is actually a good show. And it feels like they've gone to work on the show. And that was what I got from this episode. And I think some of that may have been lost when we first watched it, because not only we'd not seen the show before, there'd been a big gap. So we'd come back. But watching this episode after watching the other ones, I think you can really see the difference. All right, well, let's go through the episode then. That's probably the best way to do it. One of the first things I noticed as well, and this is something I forgot to mention on the other episode, is it's a little bit like Batman in the way that everything that S.H.I.E.L.D. have has got, like, S.H.I.E.L.D. branding on it.
Mm.
Like, this episode opens with... We talked about this the other week. It's almost like the James Bond thing, of the Indiana Jones thing, of a kind of, like, the pre-credit sequence, you know, bit of business.
The Roomba you're talking about.
The what, sorry?
The Roomba.
Yes.
Yeah.
And they throw that in, and it's got a little... It's a little bit like how on the Batman movies, that got ridiculous, where, like, he had, like, a Batman CD player in his car and shit like that. And
I the first thing I thought was that the Chitauri metal, like, that wrist thing that that guy was selling, I thought it was a really nice bangle. I quite like it.
Etsy. It'll be there. Yeah. I mean... And it's also as well, I mean, this kind of speaks to, and I suppose it's a little bit of a spoiler in the sense that it kind of implies that it goes away because of the way that we contextualise it. But something that you see a lot in these early ones is the recovery of Chitauri artifacts.
Yeah.
Is a big thing early on in the show and in the Marvel short that kind of influenced.
I think they're still trying hard at the moment to establish Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. as a TV program and also to remind the viewers that they do tie into the MCU.
Yeah. And I get
so they keep going back to the viewer and saying, hey, remember this thing that you really liked in this film? Yeah. This is in this universe.
Yeah.
And
I think also part of it was, I get the feeling that was the pitch of the show.
Yeah.
Was, hey, you know, you've got these superheroes, but what about the guys who... And that feels very pitchy, you know. Yeah. What about the guys who have to come in and sort of deal with it and put it all together, you know.
Definitely.
And I mean, the most...
And they tried to do it in Daredevil, didn't they, with what happens to the little people.
Yes.
But I think it just... It plays out so much better in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. than it does in Daredevil.
Well,
admittedly, I only saw season one, so yeah. I can't say for sure.
Well, they kind of forgot to have fun, I think, in Daredevil. That was the thing. But, you know, this whole sort of, you know, the idea of the pitch and the idea of this sort of this second tier is still a popular thing. I mean, the most popular show on television at the moment from a viewing figure's perspective is The Boys on Amazon Prime.
Okay.
And that's a similar thing. That's like a what if... Who are the people who keep the superheroes in line when they get a bit out of control and, like, kill a prostitute or something?
I've never seen an episode of that, but all I think is...
Well. Yeah. You would really like The Boys, I think.
I'm sure I would.
It's very, very fun show.
It was just something that you watched when I wasn't around the first episode.
But I mean, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Because Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is a celebration of the genre. It's not a deconstruction of it. But if you look at what was in the zeitgeist around this time, there are a lot of things like Kick-Ass and a lot of films and properties that were, you know, Watchmen had been out a few years before, that were kind of trying to look at superheroes from a slightly different perspective.
When was Kick-Ass?
Kick-Ass was...
Was it 2011?
No, it was about 2008 or 2009.
Oh, really? Was that long ago?
Well, I remember it was quite early on in Chinstroker versus Punter, because I remember it being one of the buzz films that came out.
Yeah, I remember
quite early on.
You and I went together.
Yeah, I think it was about 2000. I think it was probably around 2009.
I'm going to have a look,
okay,
because it's going to drive.
My guess would
2010.
Be, or 2010.
And interesting, Aaron Taylor Johnson. He is in the Marvel films.
Well, the funny thing is, his best friend in Kick-Ass is the guy who plays the same character he plays in the MCU, but in the X-Men movies, he plays Quicksilver in
cool.
So it's because there's a weird split thing with the rights, but yeah. So you know, we've got like I said, it's a bit of business at the beginning with the Chitauri metal, and that's still a big thing.
I like how they basically in that pre-credit sequence they show how slick they are as a team now. Like they've got their shit together.
Have you noticed how they always do that in episodes where S.H.I.E.L.D. are going to come in swinging their dick a little bit?
Exactly.
Like the larger organisation.
Yeah, so that they've got to show that they're together and they're a force to be reckoned with. It was seamless, wasn't it?
Mm.
You know, they had the sky, you're up, and Fitz and Simmons, this is your part. And
like the beginning of Age of Ultron when they're in that kind of...
Yes,
you,
totally.
You know what it reminds me of a little bit? It's like, and you kind of have to do this, and it's difficult because they want S.H.I.E.L.D. to be a good organisation, but at the same time, you need to have some kind of tension for the lead characters. And it's like what I always refer to in Star Trek as the Badmirals. You know how, like, in Star Trek, you've got, like, the Starfleet and the Federation.
Who was the guy that took over in these four lights?
Oh, yeah, Jellicoe. Yeah. He's a great example of that. Mm. But you've got... So the whole point of Star Trek is that the Federation and Starfleet are this utopian group of space hippies.
Mm.
You know, they're basically, they're the dream of what, you know, what we will eventually become. But at the same time, you know... Drama is all about...
They've still got twats in there.
Yeah, exactly. So you'll have these badmirals who will be like, no, Jean-Luc, you can't go and do this completely reasonable thing. You know, and it feels a little bit like...
Because I have an ego and it goes against what I love.
Yeah. And you get the impression that Agent Hand in this is... She's the badmiral, kind of. And you have this sense that the team, the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. team, are... kind of not the norm.
What I love, just thinking about Victoria Hand, was in the first episode that she features in, I can't remember, is it The Hub?
Mm-hmm.
So Fitz and Simmons are like absolute fangirls for her. And when they know that she's going to be there and they've heard her reputation.
They're very bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, aren't they?
She's amazing and stuff. And it just... I like the fact that you get Fitz going, oh joy, Miss Hand's giving another briefing. They're so over it, and they're becoming more seasoned in their approach to stuff and being part of the team, and they're not quite so wide eyed, and we're not in Kansas anymore. Yeah,
towing the company line kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly. I just thought that was a really nice touch because it just shows. I think it does a really clever way of showing that a period of time has elapsed without them going 6 months later, like you just see that they've obviously had enough time to solidify as a team. They've got their shit together. They've seen enough that they're kind of a wee bit jaded, but they're not without positivity and hope. They just, they're not new recruits.
Well, it's a little bit like when you get a new job and you come in and you're like, oh, everyone's lovely. Everyone's lovely here. And then 6 months later, you're like, oh, these fucking jokers. Their whole operation stinks, and you're an expert all of a sudden, It's anyone can relate to that, I think.
I as a complete tangent to that, I remember in my previous job going into a kickoff meeting for a report that was being done. I work as a graphic designer, so it was in that aspect. And the team was the team that had done the job for 4, 5, 6 years previously, bar one person who was brand new. And we came to the start-off meeting, and he was like, yeah, we're going to do this differently and that differently, and this is going to be amazing, that's going to be amazing.
Oh, my young friend.
And the guy that runs it, that I dealt with on a daily basis, looked over at me with this very wry kind of, my young friend expression, like you say.
They'll see.
Yeah, and he said to me at the end of the meeting, he'll understand. And when we had the kickoff meeting the next year, that guy was like, yeah, we're just going to do this, that, blah, blah, blah. It was like,
if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
He'd been completely beaten down.
Oh, yeah. We've all been on both sides of that fence.
Oh,
as well.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So you get the sense as well that, it's a real pack plane that they've got going on here. And like I say, Hand is kind of like Agent Hand. She's kind of swinging a dick around a little bit and kind of reminding everybody. And it kind of reminds the audience as well, the fact that you've got all of this tight sort of knit little family. But at the end of the day, they've got these very expensive toys, and some bureaucrat could come in at any point and just say, no, you're gone. You're going over here. So it starts to feel very precarious, which you haven't really heard before.
Yeah.
I think what's really interesting in these... Oh, no, go on.
Sorry. I'm just saying about, you know, no, you're gone, whatever. I like the fact that they sort of make out that May's being a dick to Skye when she says she's no good to us on the plane.
Yeah.
But it's that fake out thing that actually she knows that
she's being honest. She's just being very literal.
She is being honest, but she's also doing it for her own end because she knows that Skye's going to come off the plane and do her best work.
Yeah.
And I think that's a theme that we've seen in the last few episodes, that May looks unconventional or hard-ass on the surface, but actually she is very much a team player and has her team in mind and is rooting for each of them individually, but she does it in her own way. Yeah. She's that classic person that doesn't wear their heart on their sleeve, but she will show her affection and love or, you know, solidarity in other ways.
Well, she doesn't care what people think of her as
well. No, she doesn't.
But the thing that's interesting is my only, and I don't even know if this is a criticism as much as just a sort of observation, but I almost feel like they could have padded it out more.
Mm.
Like, you're starting to see, for example, Grant is one of the first people to actually defend Skye. So you see his character development in relation to her.
Yeah.
And I almost feel like they could have milked that for a season.
Mm.
Like, they could have had, like, you know, even in season two. So what you're starting to see here is that it doesn't really hang about that much, the show.
I just thought of what I wanted to say.
Oh, okay. I will have probably edited all of that out, so people will be like, what is she even talking about? Well, no, before we get to that, though, Hannah, I'm fucking joking. Let me tell you about Stanley and Jack Kirby.
It's so on the periphery of my mind.
Oh, is it going to stay? God. Is it going to go?
You asshole.
Did I do a reverse Inception?
Oh, I know what it is. Okay. Do not distract me again.
You're so easy to confuse.
Fuck you. When you were saying about how they could string the whole Ward and Skye thing out a lot more, one thing I love about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., and this is the first time that you see it, is they will reveal and solidify stuff to you pretty early on. I mean, we're 11 episodes in, and you are getting a big explanation of something that's happened to Coulson that they have built up.
Made you wait 5 years for a revelation. Exactly. Like that.
I mean, you've only had to wait 11 episodes for the reveal that Coulson was brought back from the dead.
It feels like, as a show,
been dead for days.
Yeah, it feels like, as a show, it's learning from the mistakes other shows before it made. Yeah. As far as when do you reveal, how long do you... Because that was a big thing, like, this whole idea of... Like, Lost was hugely influential, and then you had lots of other... You had, like, The Happening, and you had lots of, like, The Event. Mm. There were lots of these, ooh, what's going on kind of shows. And I mean, Heroes kind of was like that as well. And a lot of those shows died on their arse. They were like the lesser grunge bands that came out after Nirvana, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that by the time you got... I think Fringe was part of the figuring it out. But by the time you got to Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., I think that these TV shows that were run by the Whedons and the J.J. Abrams and the Alex Kurtzmans of the world, they'd found the... And I think that the big Rosetta Stone of that was that... What you need to do is there's two things you need to do, right? The first thing is you need to start sowing the seeds for the next interesting plot element just before you wrap one up.
Mm.
So audiences are already invested in that when you're given the answer for the one before. And secondly, you have to make people care about the characters, because if they like the characters, that will get them through it.
I think, though, Enterprise did this really well.
Yeah, mini arcs, almost. Yeah,
mini arcs. Like, S.H.I.E.L.D. is amazing at it. And as, like, I don't think it's a spoiler to say that that happens more and more as the seasons go on.
Yeah, all TV shows do that.
Like, obviously, they build the suspense up. It's not that they just reveal it too quickly, but they don't prolong stuff for the sake of, you know, 9 episodes because they're waiting for the end of season.
They're not trying to trick you into keep watching the show.
No, they're not. It's not like I remember you saying once about The Walking Dead, like boring, 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 major reveal at the end. I've got to watch
it's
next
what
episode.
Noel, our podcasting friend, calls empty calories.
Right.
It's the empty calories of modern television, where you watch an episode and fuck all happens and you're not interested, but they get you at the end and you want to know, you got to know what happens.
I'm so pleased that I remembered what that was. That would bug me all night.
Yeah. Yeah, you would be...
That would have been my leg of beef.
You would have gone to bed feeling constipated if you hadn't managed to...
Feels so good.
We all win. Okay, so we get this great bit of business, which is kind of central, I guess, to the episode where they say, right, okay, Skye's got to get off the plane, but then you realise that actually what's happening is that Fitz and Simmons and Ward, and as they will learn in a character twist towards the end of the episode... are actually in cahoots to get Skye to go rogue, because she's the only person really who can with impunity go and do her thing. You know?
She's the only one with the ability to find him.
Yes, but also she's outside of the chain of command as well. You know, yeah, so the consequences, like, she doesn't have to worry about her career as well. You know?
And the others, like, okay, Ward and May... are great when they know where it is and they've got to go in and, like, defeat the bad guys and get to the person.
Yeah.
Fitz and Simmons could, like, doctor the shit out of any of them.
Yeah.
But Skye's the one that can find where
she's got, like, the soft skills.
She's, yeah.
The interpersonal.
She's necessary.
Yeah.
And I think that's one thing this episode showed, is that she is actually a necessary part of the team. She's not decorative, she's not an add-on, she is essential.
Well, it's the way that they refer to her as a consultant, and it's said disparagingly, but it's kind of right, because a lot of the time, like, if you're within an organisation that is a bureaucracy, sometimes you need to bring somebody in who isn't mired with the view of how the company works and can actually kind of make... absurd kind of blue sky suggestions.
Yeah.
And that's, I guess, where she sort of fits there. Mm. We go over to Coulson and we see that he's been kept by Rayner and, oh, what's the guy's name? Poe.
Poe. And basically, the Teletubbies?
I think Poe from Star Wars. Yeah, see, I go to Star Wars, you go to Teletubbies. So and you get a little bit of Coulson doing the classic, being a bit of a wise ass whilst being tortured.
I think he does... devastated extremely well, like fake devastated. Like, he looks like he's absolutely not coping at the very beginning, and then they take him into that room and you see him with the tweezer up his sleeve.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
he's,
yeah.
He's not as bad as he
yeah,
feels.
Yeah, I mean, the thing you have to remember,
he's tougher than he looks.
I mean, he's shown in a lot of the show in a paternal light, but, you know, he's a spy.
Yeah,
you know,
and so he's got the chops.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, there's a reason he's level 8.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And
I put a note, no one ever wants an electric shock up the nose. I'd be a terrible spy. I'd talk immediately.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I'd be terrible. I'd be like, what do you need?
Yeah, yeah.
I'm only level 2.
Yeah. There's a great bit in the pilot of Firefly where they've captured these two bad guys and they push this bad guy down on the ground, and he looks up and he's like, he looks at Nathan Fillion and he's like, wherever you go, we will find you. You will fall asleep. We will find you. Whatever happens, we will find you. And Nathan Fillion's like, okay. And just kicks him into the turbine of the ship and he just explodes. And then they drop the next guy down and he's like, right. And he's like, it's all good. I can help you. We're fine. It's just this really kind of like realistic moment. But and they also, they tell you that Mike, the J. August Richards character, is dead. You saw the explosion. But you know how it is with TV shows. If you don't see the body...
believe anything until you clock to your eyes on it.
Yeah. So we learn that basically we've got the structure here. You've got Poe. You're told that Poe is the brains. Rayner is the recruiter. And the mysterious clairvoyant is the boss. Now, what we don't know at this point, and they're kind of playing with it a little bit here, is, you know, is the clairvoyant literally a clairvoyant, or is it just a name, like a moniker, you know?
Are you saying clairvoyant?
Clairvoyant.
Isn't it just clairvoyant?
Well, both are correct. It depends on your accent.
Is this going to be a whole cashew debate again?
No, it's not going to be a segue. I can tell you
a
that.
A seeg.
So we get a sense of what their relationship is. So Sky's gone rogue. Mm. We see the mannequins and the nuclear.
Not rogue.
Shut up. Rogue way.
Just for the
rogue
listeners.
You. It's rogue you. I think you will find.
For listeners that don't know, Mike didn't realise that Segway was pronounced Segway. He thought it was pronounced Sieg, as in league with an S. And yeah.
May all of your disgraces be private ones is my advice to you guys. So we see the mannequins and the nuclear test stand. It gives a freaky and it adds to the fact that we talked last time about how Edison Poe is very much like that Hannibal Lecter kind of freaky.
I've called him Evil Dude Poe in my notes.
And like, you know, you get the impression that like, you just know he loves chess. He's one of those bad guys, one of those kind of like fancies
himself.
He's
trying so hard to be Hannibal Lecter.
Fancies himself as a bit of an intellectual. Mm. And when he's talking about how, you know, I like the peace here and all that, it's very much kind of in keeping with that. But what we see in this episode is that's kind of a bit of a fake out in the way that.
It's totally a fake out. And actually, he's a massive pawn.
Yeah. It's like and really, you know, Raina is. I mean, she's shown in the last episode as being kind of deferential to him. But, you know, she was introduced first, so, you know.
And they also sort of make out that she's a bit of a fangirl who doesn't have any kind of strength in
these
situations.
Well, she's doe-eyed, that's the thing.
And she is doe-eyed, but she's also, she's got steel running through her.
Yeah. It's as though, like, the whole flower dress thing.
Mm.
And Coulson says to her later, why flowers? And she's like, well, who doesn't like flowers?
Mm.
And it's as though she's just like, well, I'm just the pretty girl in the pretty dress, so nobody sees me as a threat from within the organisation. And that's why I think it's interesting. And I'd forgotten all of this, is that I kind of took the piss a little bit about how Poe was this kind of cliched villain. But that was kind of the point.
Mm.
Was he was the guy who you would just expect to be the villain, like the Jared Harris character in Fringe, you know.
Definitely,
they were very much playing on that kind of type. But he was a cliche because he's not actually the bad guy. They kind of, it's a switcheroo
He's a minion.
Yeah. Mm. And he ultimately ends up being blind.
He's killed by a phone to his ear.
Yeah, to the real threat, which is this ambitious, you know, little girl. We see Sky scams her way into the money guy's house. We see Ward interrogating, taking over the interrogation.
Yeah. I love the fact that Sky sort of takes the matters into her own hands and decides to become Melinda May because as much as they butt heads, she does see her as the epitome of the spy.
Yeah.
Like, she's the person to be.
Yeah. So if you're going to emulate somebody.
Exactly. And that goes with the outfit that she's wearing and, you know, the sunglasses and the attitude. And you can see it on her face that, yeah, I'm a badass.
Yeah.
You know, I'm cool.
But also it makes you realise how far from that Sky is as well, because she does look like she's play acting, you know.
But also, did you notice, like, when she takes down those two guards, that she sort of seems
more capable?
Yes, but also surprised with herself, like, oh my God, I can do this.
Yeah,
like, I've took two guys down. Look how amazing I am.
And because in the early episodes, you saw kind of, you know, her doing the sort of long workout session. So you get the feeling that she is starting to actually get the muscle memory of.
And it's nice to see that she has actually evolved in that way. And she looks pretty proud of it, even though if you talk to her about it, she'd probably scoff at it.
Yeah.
She is proud of what's happening to her and how she's developing.
Although she's becoming the man. You know, it's almost like the younger her would probably not approve.
Oh, totally. Did you also notice, you know, how they get one of the guards to do all the coding because the tech guy doesn't actually know the tech? He's a stunt guy for Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I looked him up because I thought, I sort of feel like you're going to be, I wondered if it was going to be the brother of someone. But yeah, he's a stunt guy for like 20 or 30 episodes of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., so There you go.
Nice. Well, they probably figured he had to have his head kicked in the scene. So,
Yeah.
So we see Rayner go up the ranks. We see Poe's grisly death by phone.
Mm.
We learn that May was actually being quite crafty about Skye. And I like the fact as well that she doesn't even volunteer that.
No.
She only mentions it when it's dug out. It's almost as though you almost get the impression that she'd have just kept that to herself.
Absolutely. She's not out to be liked.
She's not like, guys, look, I know you probably hate me right now, but the way, couldn't give a fuck.
No. No, she's all about doing the right thing for the team.
Yeah. Now, my favourite scene in this episode, which I was really surprised by how well played it was, and also really surprised I couldn't remember it, was the scene when Rayner is trying to talk Coulson into cooperating.
Mm-hmm.
It's a really well filmed, and I don't think Clark Gregg has ever been better, and I don't even know if he's been better since. He's so good in that scene. He genuinely looks kind of defiant but wounded and kind of compliant and just really conflicted. He plays it so well.
Mm.
And Ruth Negga's really good in that scene as well. Like, she's really convincing. Like, you know, you would be... At first, you're like, oh, okay, she's trying to talk you into it. And then you're like, no, fucking, she's right, man. You know, go for it. And
that's why she's so dangerous.
Yeah, but you can also see that as an actor, she's got... And we knew this about Clark Gregg anyway, because he's, like, you know, carried a TV show for 7 years. But you can see a real charisma with Ruth Negga. I genuinely believe that, you know, she could be a film actress. You know, she's got a kind 100%. Of... A lot going on there.
Mm.
And just watching that scene
there... She's great in Preacher.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm. And she's been great in a whole bunch of movies as well. But, I mean, I just think that the way that that scene is shot and performed and what it means to the story, like, where we are... is I just think that that scene is the best thing about this show so far.
Yeah.
And it's one that I don't even remember, and I think maybe part of it is that when you watch a show for a podcast, you watch it more closely.
Mm.
I am re-watching this as well now. Maybe the night that this episode was first on in 2013 or whenever, I was on my phone or... not in the zone for whatever, it didn't land, but no, that's really good stuff. So when he does actually basically, because I mean, the whole point of the scene is she's essentially her saying, well, don't you want to know? You know, and also she talks a little bit about how the relationship that he was in at the time, how that person was lied to, and basically she gets through to him through a combination of just reaching out to his sense of curiosity, but also kind of turning him against S.H.I.E.L.D. a little bit as well.
I, just speaking on that relationship thing, it's interesting. I can't remember, apart from the top-level broad storylines, I can't remember where everything goes in the seasons to come.
Yeah, and be careful.
Absolutely. But I thought, and this isn't a spoiler, like it's more of looking back, I can't believe that they have mentioned his relationship with the cellist in this episode, one with Ward previously, and the only reason it's really apparent to me is we've just watched, it's on a side note, Avengers Assemble and Age of Ultron.
Yeah.
And his relationship with the cellist is mentioned in there as well.
In both? It's crazy. I mean,
yeah.
It's like, I mean...
And it was like in such a little detail.
Yeah, and you don't...
But it's almost mentioned in a way to tie the two together. Yeah,
and like, you don't waste dialogue scenes in $250 million movies.
No.
You know, and it's weird. And it's a lot of it is just like Tony Stark just mumbling small talk.
If that's a spoiler, I apologise.
No, that isn't a spoiler.
I honestly can't remember if, like, I don't think that has anything to do with the future. It's certainly nothing I remember.
I think that really...
I just thought it was really interesting that, for starters, that they mention it in Avengers Assemble.
Yeah.
And it had only been apparent because we'd seen it in that exchange between Ward and Coulson in the car when they were having their, like, kind of little... getting to know
bonding,
each other thing. And I thought, and I said to you at the time, oh, that's weird. They talk about the cellist.
Mm.
And then we watched Age of Ultron and there was just a very tiny mention, like Iron Man's coming in the door and he said something about, are you sure there's no way you could get down to Portland to see her, or like it was.
Oh, no, that
such...
was that was Avengers Assemble.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Because Coulson's dead in Age of Ultron.
Oh, of course he is. It was such a small mention though that they had there, and then of course they mention it in this, and it was just, yeah. I just thought it was such a nice way to tie the two, like the MCU to the TV show, and a weird thing to tie it with.
Well, that's one of the things that I kind of rather condescendingly liked seeing non-geeks, seeing muggles enjoy about the MCU films, was when I'd see people who had never really been geeks starting to see, oh, wow, you know, gosh, I just went to see that Incredible Hulk film. And Samuel L. Jackson turns up. So that's like in the same world. And then seeing that become more sophisticated over the 25 films. And I'm just thinking about, like, you know, being a Star Trek fan in the 80s and 90s and early 2000s and just being like, feeling like you were part of a cult.
Mm.
A cult of virgins, if you will. and it's like, we were like the opposite of the Waco cult. They were like a sexy orgy cult.
Don't drink my Kool-Aid.
yeah. We were drinking our Kool-Aid alone in the 90s, you know. And but it is funny because, you know, I mean, I remember that. I remember seeing Picard turn up in a pilot of Deep Space Nine and all of these things. And it's just... it's difficult to not be like, oh, yes. It's taken everybody else a while.
Oh, my young friend.
My young non-virgin friend. you know, it's seeing all of that. I mean, that's why I think it cracks me up when you see young executives at CBS when they were launching Star Trek Discovery saying, oh, we'd really like to create a shared Star Trek universe like the Marvel universe. And I'm like... or, like, I don't know, the fucking Star Trek universe that, like, was 20 years before that. But okay, you know, whatever. But, yeah, so it's good to have these reminders that this is, there is a larger fabric, if you will.
Absolutely. When they get to the compound where they know Coulson's being held, I love the fact that the super soldiers are still no match for May.
Yeah.
She still kicks their ass without, like, Ward has whatever that watch thing is with the poison to be able to defeat them.
It's already James Bond.
But she just kicks her ass. She's just that good. I just love her as a character because she's just so self-sufficient and badass. And
And also she's got, one of the things that you see here that you see a lot more of later in the show is that she's got a very finely tuned bullshit detector as well.
Absolutely.
Like, she just knows when people are politicking and, you know, isn't interested in... it's like the whole reality TV, the kind of, I'm not here to make friends, you know?
Yeah.
Is for the ethos. So you see, so you get all this stuff, of course, and Raina, and she justifies her ends. Basically, what you get the sense of is that the clairvoyant is basically in the business of creating super soldiers, and they are very interested in how Coulson was, you know, the Lazarus effect or whatever, how he was brought back from the dead. They feel like, wow, well, if we could have super soldiers who are immune from dying, then, you know, now we're in fucking business, you know?
Yeah.
And that's the incentive there. You get, I think it's interesting, and this is something that I definitely only got from the rewatch, is... Coulson kind of repeating the "I trust the system" mantra from the hub.
Yeah,
you know, you know, what's also really good here is it's really nice seeing the team solidified. Like, there's a hero shot, you know, where they're all kind of lined up in the desert.
Yeah,
and it feels like, you know, that's, if this was a movie, that would have been like a trailer moment. That was the kind of, you know, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. assemble kind of moment.
Mm-hmm.
I really like, I mentioned earlier on that I think it's really nicely directed. I think there's a great use of location and the desert and that environment. You see this sort of place in Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. One of the only good things about that film is there's a really interesting sequence set in one of these faux towns that were set up. These were a real thing. You'd see them out in like New Mexico and stuff, where they were built and they were abandoned, and they're still there and they're creepy as fuck.
Mm.
And they're really cinematic as well. Mm. I also think that there's a really nice score in this episode that speaks to what I mentioned earlier about that you really get the sense that the production value has been upped.
I thought it was nice to get the answer about why Coulson doesn't have the muscle memory for, you know, in a previous episode, yes. He couldn't remember how to do whatever it was with the gun, like reload it or disarm it or whatever it was. You get the answer to that. His brain has been completely rewired. Mm. And up till then, you're sort of like, is he the same person? Is he a different person?
Yeah.
Like, actually completely bodily, you know.
What is the soul?
Yeah, yeah. And this is... I like the fact that they answer it. Like, you can just close that particular question off and file it, you know.
Well, and the other thing is this idea of questions and secrets being revealed.
Mm.
I think another thing that's really important, I sort of touched on this earlier, is that... that's not even really what the show's about.
No.
It's about the characters, and I think that's what shows like Lost and Heroes got wrong, is that all there was answers. And that, whereas on this show, they're there to fuel the stories, but ultimately the stories are just there to illuminate the characters.
And I think as the seasons go on, it becomes less like that as well. It's not so much about answering the question. It's about letting the events happen and the storyline evolve.
And how do our team respond to that? What does it tell us about them?
And what do our choices of response mean for the team in a wider context?
Yes.
And what knock-on effects that have.
And one of a really great example of that, I mean, I always use this as an example, but it's probably because it's the show that I know the most about. But with, like, Star Trek The Next Generation, you know, this was a show that basically created the modern science fiction. You know, it aired in 1987 when there was literally no science fiction, fantasy or genre television on at all. It was soap operas and sitcoms. That was it.
Yeah.
And nobody knew how to make genre television. It just hadn't been done for like 20 years.
Yeah.
And what they did earlier on was, which was a mistake, because a lot of the writers on that show were the same people who wrote for the original Star Trek in the 60s, but they were now old people. They were elderly people. And what they did was they came up with these science fiction ideas, and it was almost like an anthology show where every week you'd get like a new planet and a new guest star, and they would have a story, and our crew would kind of come in and be part of that. But it was ultimately about the story.
Mm.
And then 2/3 of the way through the second season, a writer called Michael Piller came in and kind of became showrunner on it. And what he said was, right, we're going to completely change the focus of this show, and it is now going to be about our crew.
Mm.
It's going to be about our characters. So instead of having a Alien of the Week episode or a... time travel episode or a temporal anomaly episode, we're going to have a Worf episode or a Geordi episode. And
you can so see that in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., can't you?
Yeah, you know, but
the Ward episode.
Yeah, yeah, Fitzinson. Absolutely. But also specifically, what I'm driving at, the really specific comparison, is that what they would do is, a pillar would be like, you can still have guest characters, you can still have somebody come in, you know, you can still have David Ogden Steers come in to be the guest actor of the week, and he can have his own storyline, but what we're interested in is what does that tell us about Riker, or you know,
and what's their response to the storyline going on?
And that was when the show became the show.
Yeah.
And I think that when I say that Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and Fringe have had the benefit of hindsight, that's kind of the thing. And I think that you can see that happening from an accelerated perspective. You know, it took Star Trek The Next Generation 2 years to do that, but here that it's straight away. So, and where are we?
I've only got a couple of very small points, so say whatever you want to say about it.
Okay, well, same here, so I'll just finish up my notes. So yeah, we've got the stuff with the flashback with the wrong glass doctor and Coulson's, you know, begging to die whilst you've got the super snippy AI robot rebuilding his brain. He gets rescued, and there's a nice moment where he disengages Sky's bracelet as well, which is kind of really the ultimate show of trust. It almost feels as well, I mean, this is the first episode back after the break, but it kind of feels like it's the end of the first story arc in the way that the story started with Sky being brought in. And by him taking the bracelet
off... Can she be trusted?
It's kind of she's graduated, you know, in some way.
For sure. I only had a couple of notes about the particular scene you were talking about. So the doctor, the scene where he sees the doctor and he sees who he thinks is his Tahitian nurse or waitress giving him drinks or whatever, or masseuse or whatever it is. But the look on his face when it's just this miserable white woman and he looks absolutely horrified by
That's what we call in the business slightly. A boner killer.
Yeah, she was. I also thought the doctor, when he gets into the back seat of the car to have the spy chat with the doctor about what the doctor's role in, quote marks, Tahiti was.
Yeah.
I've put a note saying, Doc does good shiver lips.
He does. He also gives good righteous indignation. He reminds me a lot of Jackie Charles in Seinfeld. It's like, it's what they did to you was incorrigible. It was egregious.
Yeah. I just thought, it's quite hard to do the whole shiver lips thing. I thought, no, you absolutely cannot. You look like you're saying, wow, 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 without producing any noise.
Well, whatever gets you to the place, you know. I mean, it's the method.
Yeah, no, I thought he was good. And I also... I'd forgotten completely that Mike Peterson ends up being controlled.
Yeah. He's got the evil eye, isn't he?
Yeah, and I felt really sad about that because, you know, he's a good guy.
Poor Mike Peterson.
Yeah, he's just, all he wants to do is be a good father.
He gets fucked at every turn, hasn't he?
I have a couple of very minor spoiler things. Nothing that big.
Yeah, I've got like one, so we'll...
Just summing up, I thought the episode was so strong. It was 9.5 out of 10 for me. I thought it was really great. It solidifies the team as a whole. It was so great to get more of a Coulson storyline, so he's at the forefront of what's happening.
And they talk about how he doesn't have a family and who just his parents as well.
Yeah, because he... Up to this point, he's the only one that you haven't actually learned any more about.
But you, what you learn is he's got nothing else.
No, this is his family. Yeah. And it's nice to see that his family went into bat for him. And that's also reinforced in the fact that when Victoria Hand says, you know, no level 8 agent should be this necessary, basically.
Yeah.
And she can't understand why Nick Fury... wants to know how he is, and obviously that's to do with the fact he's been brought back from the dead. But what's behind that? Nick Fury looks at him as his family, perhaps. Yeah. And that's sort of what it comes down to, is he is much loved by his team.
Well, it's like if you,
and potentially by the people above him.
Yeah, it's like if you... It's the old thing about how if... and this is a very Roddenberry-esque thing. It's like, well, if you lose sight of the people... What are we fighting for?
Yeah.
And also, I mean, that's a military thing, you know, the whole no man left behind kind of thing. You know, it's the fact that you do have to sort of go back. Mm. And the other thing I like as well is, I mean, we haven't really mentioned this, but one thing that the episodes do is that you have not a post-credit sequence, but all the episodes end with the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. logo coming up, and then you get another scene. So what they're doing there is they're trying to kind of elicit the same type of thing that you get with the end credit scenes in the movies.
Absolutely.
Even though it's not an end credit scene, because the end credits of TV shows are too short to do that. So they found another way of doing it. And what they tend to do is they're usually either, a bit like the movies, either a little plot stinger, a bit of or sometimes they're like a comedy beat. It's nice because what it means is that the show kind of gets to have its cake and eat it. It means that the show can end on a nice... kind of character bonding, kind of, you know, Sky having the bracelet taken off, and you know, the structure of the episode ends on a nice character beat. But you can still have that little, don't forget to tune in next week, because, you know, all of this crazy shit's going to happen. Okay, well, let's finish up then, and we will, but before we take a short break, I just want to tell people how they can reach us and do a little bit of that kind of business. So, Our email address is rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com, so please get in touch. That would be good. You can find us on Twitter at rewatchproj. What we'll do now is we will say fare thee well to anybody who is watching the show for the first time and doesn't want to be spoiled. But for all of those of you who either don't give a shit or have seen the show before, we will be back in just a moment.
So long, farewell, if we do say adieu, adieu to you.
Goodbye. You have to go creepy at the end. Okay, so we'll be back in just a second.
I'm clearance level 6. I know that Agent Coulson was killed in action before the battle in New York. Got the full report.
Welcome to level 7.
Sorry, that corner was really dark and I couldn't help myself. I think there's a bulb out.
And we are back for the spoiler section of this episode of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. So, Hannah, you said you didn't have much. I don't have much here, which is weird, actually, because I think this speaks to what you were talking about earlier on, this whole mini-arc thing and the fact that they'll be like, right, okay, we'll get rid of this bit of business.
Mm.
Whereas when you've got shows like Babylon 5 and The X-Files, where you've got these really long arcs, you kind of have to be like, yeah, and then this, which relates to this in season 4 and this in season 6. There's a little bit of that, but because they're micro arcs, they're kind of closed off in a lot of ways. So it's almost as though we had more to talk about in the spoiler zone 5 episodes back than we have now, because they're starting to wrap up these initial
storylines. Because it's like, oh my gosh, when are they going to get to the fact that Coulson was brought back from the dead, you know, by nefarious means and blah, blah, blah.
Also, we have the shittiest memories. I think that's factoring into it as well. But what did you want to mention?
I only had a couple of minor things. I think, well, I say minor. One of them, it's a major spoiler, but it's a minor thing that happens in this particular episode. I think that they're at a point where they're trying to really solidify the group as a family, because they want Ward's defection to be super shocking.
Yeah.
And if I remember correctly, Ward and Sky get together before the defection, don't they? I'm pretty sure they do. I think they have a romantic relationship. They're doing everything they can to really make him a key, confident member of the team. Like, we trust you, we think you're amazing, because I remember how shocked I was.
Well,
I'm really good at picking
The non-spoiler part of this episode, I mentioned about how I'm surprised they didn't milk things longer.
Yeah.
And I think this is kind of why they didn't, because I think the fact that they were like, oh, okay, shit, okay, well, the Hydra reveal's coming down the track, so, and we're going to have Ward's going to be our kind of sacrificial lamb to that storyline. So we need to make him now Team Sky and part of it. So whereas I think that if they hadn't have done that, if he'd have stayed, quote, a good guy, I think that they would have had the whole him not being sure about Sky and then him coming around played over a much longer period of time.
Yeah.
But I think that it was necessitated that they had to speed that up a little bit.
Definitely. But I think it's a good thing, because you very quickly feel like you take him into your bosom.
Yeah.
You know, he's part of the team, he's much loved. So when it's revealed that he's on the bad side, you feel like he's cheated on you.
Yeah.
As a viewer, because you're like, well, fuck you, mate. Like, I loved you.
You don't do that.
The only other spoiler I had was that I kind of loved the fact that Skye's faux Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. outfit is basically what she ends up wearing in later seasons.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, that, it kind of is her outfit.
It's like a slightly more off-the-peg version. But,
but it's like, it's kind of like preview. A preview of things to come is... This is how she's going to look. She might have shorter hair or whatever, but this is what she's going to look like.
Yeah.
This is Quake.
Yeah. I mean,
she just doesn't know it yet.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, my spoiler things were, there's the usual, you know, Ward watch. kind of thing, yeah. You know, which you've kind of covered. But for me, the big one, and I'm surprised you didn't mention this, I actually even saw you writing notes on your phone when it came up, is that...
What have I missed?
Is that when, I think it's Poe, he's talking to Coulson, Coulson mentions S.H.I.E.L.D., and Poe says, oh, S.H.I.E.L.D., yeah, the clairvoyant has sees the end of that.
Oh, no.
So... The clairvoyant.
I think I was writing something else.
Yeah, that is all of my spoiler stuff. So is that all of your spoiler stuff?
Yeah.
Okay, so...
I just have one last spoiler.
Okay.
My pronunciation's better than yours.
No, you've already spoiled that. Okay, so that's us for this episode. What's the next episode we're covering, Hannah?
Okay, so episode 12 is Seeds, not Segue or Seed. It's Seeds. While investigating a problem at S.H.I.E.L.D. Academy, Coulson and May turn up unexpected information about Skye's parents.
Oh, it's all go. All right, so we are out of here like last Tuesday. That's us done. Bye-bye.
See ya.
Podcast is part of the Pod Syndicate family. For more criminally compelling shows, articles, and conversations, head to wearepodsyndicate.com.